So, hello, fellow Starfleet officers. Let me continue with my report on the planetary surveys I started already before. I'm sorry that I'm in my off-duty uniform today, but I'm actually off-duty, so sorry. Let's compare OpenGL and Vulkan, right? So we know about the Ogilians who are living on OpenGL, and we know about the Vulcans living in Vulkan. And breaking the fourth wall here, that's the joke, Vulkan, right? Star Trek, haha, funny. If you don't like the joke, I'm sorry, I'm just gonna continue with this one and roll with it. So let's see what are the differences between the Ogilians and the Vulcans, right? And specifically, let's find out how do they actually draw triangles, right? Because like this is for us the difference, right? Like how do we characterize different species? Obviously, by the way, how they draw triangles. What's a triangle? This thing over there obviously is a triangle. The question is like, how do they define them? Like, what is a triangle for them, right? Does it consist of three corners? Yes, obviously, but how do you define those three corners? Also, it's super important, how do they color them? How does color work? How does texturing work? And finally, after the texturing is done, how does, how do you actually draw the fully colored triangles? So let's put this into perspective, right? So like I'm not talking about the Borg anymore because right now it's about Vulcans and Ogilians. But as we know from the Borgs, they love their engines, right? So like they're super controlled, they're super technical, and they like try to do everything perfect for you, right? They strive for perfection. Some of those engines are called Unity, Unreal, and Epic. Like they do and try to do all of the things for you. On the other hand, we have libraries. Like engines can use libraries, and those libraries might be DirectX on Windows or Metal on Mac. And then there are somehow some parts in between, which are the Ogilians and the Vulcans. And so let's take a look at OpenGL and the Ogilians living there. We found the Ogilians in 1992, right? So like this is when we got to know them, how they work, and how we can interact with them. They are quite an evolved species, so like they can do a lot of things. They can draw triangles, which is awesome for us. And they are like super diverse, except for they don't like apples. I don't know why they don't like apples, but obviously the Ogilians cannot work with apples. Also, at the second edition, or at the second iterations, or the second step of evolution, they introduced shaders, which is super nice because they help us like be more versatile with the language. And this is how they define their structure, right? So, like, we have in their language vertex specification, vertex shader, tessellation, geometry shaders, vertex post processing, primitive assembly, rasterization, fragment shaders, and at the end, per sample operations. Those things are so-called semi-fixed because, like, in their language, we can change some parts of it, but also some parts are fixed. Yeah, exactly. So, like, everything we call a shader is something we can actually interact with. So, like, the tessellation, the geometry, and the fragment shader is something we can control when we talk to the Ogilians. Sadly, there is, like, we cannot change their way of thinking, right? So, we cannot change so much how, let's say, they work with memory or something. So, but what we can do is like we can create the shaders. This is how they speak when they say shaders. This is a so-called, let me just verify, it's a fragment shader. And what we do there is we just take the texture, like the color of the triangle, and put it onto the fragment which is currently rendered. This thing is always shipped by the Ogilians as text. So what happens is that if you want to speak to them, you take this shader, you compile it with your universal translator, and then put it into the binary form, into the OpenGL. The GL also then takes care of like compiling it and actually error checking, which is quite interesting because you have to do it like on all the hardware and like all of the drivers are doing the shader compilation. Another thing we can do is loading. It's actually like how do we do memory, right? So we want to make sure that they understand one specific thing about the triangles. So we need to reserve some space into their brains, right? So this is in this case we generate a texture. But this is all we can tell. We just tell them, hey, generate a texture for me, and then it's fine. And then we can bind this texture at a specific point in time, and in the end, we can take text image from an Android image and just put it into the memory of the GPU. Oh, sorry, in their brain. Sorry, not getting out of character again. And that's fine. Like, this gets the thing done, right? We can say, like, okay, this is the texture. I don't really care where it lives in the GPU memory. Just render it for me. Those are the Ojulians, right? So now that we have a rough base understanding how Ojulians work, let's take a look into the Vulcans. We know they are an Ojulian colony, right? So like they have some traits together, they are based on the same thing, but they also evolved from the Ojulians. They're kind of logical, and we have to tell them something like, okay, what are fields, right? So we have to tell them how do we interact with each other. They're super efficient, but sometimes it can also be like super interesting to like actually talk to them because they speak a different language. They don't speak the Kotlin or the Java we are used to. They're speaking C, C++. So this way, if we in our Android environment want to speak to the Vulcans, we obviously have to use the NDK. So let's take a closer look at this one. If you remember the quick overview I had with the geometry shaders and the squiggly lines. What's up with my microphone? Somebody can help me.
Technology. So who couldn't hear me? Should I start from the start? Hi, I'm Mario. Welcome to the survey mission. We skip the Ojulian part and directly go to Vulcans. Thank you. This graphic shows you already. You can do a lot of things. Like, if you want to like interact with the Vulcans, you have to always keep this one in mind. Obviously, you cannot see it, and this is intentional because there's a lot of things happening here. I also have to admit I'm not understanding it. Like, I'm not totally understanding it. I'm understanding it enough to draw a triangle, and this is enough. Everybody just wants to draw one triangle, and then they're happy with it. But this also gives me flexibility, right? So, like, if I can say, like, I want to change a specific part of the rendering or I do something differently, I can do this.
Exactly. So what I said is like you, right? So if you want to interact with a Vulcan, you have to take care of it. Like you have to initiate the conversation. You have to like have them under control and like tell them what you want out of them. And also like where would you like them to put stuff when they're thinking about things. Let's just take a closer look at this one, right? So I was talking about shaders before, you know? This was the code I was sharing before on the screen. And this actually will not be understood by a Vulcan. Vulcan does not speak GLSL, like the language we saw with main, and there's a fragment somewhere, and we assign a fragment to another one. They don't understand what it works. How this works. The only thing they understand is SPIRV. Come afterwards to me, and then I click this link, and I tell you what SPIRV means. SPIRV, yes. Luckily, there are tools for that, right? So the driver, in this case, from Vulcan doesn't come with a compiler, but there's an external compiler. So I can call this external compiler called ShaderC, which creates the SPIRV. Probably there's a better way of pronouncing this one. And puts it into the binary format, which I then can read inside Vulcan and assign to the parts I need. The other way of doing this one, if I don't want to execute the shader C library directly, or the shader C binary library, binary directly, too much Vulcan, I can just use Android Studio. Android Studio has under source main a shader file, a shader folder, and if I put my shader files in there, it compiles it automatically for me, and I don't have to worry about shader C anymore. Which is also, I don't know if you know the Google samples, for instance, they still use the shader C one. I tried to compile them, and I failed miserably until I moved them under the source main shader file folder. Then Android Studio takes care of it, and I just need to load the binary file of it, which is super nice.
Now let's take a closer look into the management of memory, right? I have to understand the Vulcan good enough standing in front of me to understand, okay, do I want to put it onto his left brain side or on the right brain side? And which one is faster for me right now? And or already did I have put too much information in one side of his brain? And those kind of things I have to keep in mind, and I also have to put into, like, okay, do I want to, like, remind myself about what I just was talking to him about? Like, should I access this memory again of his, or should I not? Don't be scared. There's C code incoming. If you are scared of C code, just stay. It's gonna be fine. Yes, it's a lot of code, and it's also already skipped. I took out the global parts of this structure when you initialize it, because those are common fields I didn't want to repeat. But what you're seeing here is, like, I'm creating a new object, and I assign it with values. So for instance, I say that the image type is a VK image type 2D. So I want to have a two-dimensional texture. So there are three-dimensional textures, which is like a volume. And I'm pretty sure there are also one-dimensional textures, which is just a line with colors. The interesting thing is, like, when I want to create a new image, I also have to specify the dimensions. Did I do it again? Thank you. So this one is off, I guess. So I'm just gonna get closer. Oh my god, it's wireless, right? So I don't have to worry about it, and I just undress in front of stage, so take pictures of it. Thank you. So this was obviously the Klingons didn't want me to talk about Vulcans, and they threw down my phaser. So, like, something is just going wrong. Or maybe it's Q. Like, has anybody seen Q right now? Maybe he's having his games going on again. I'm just taking this opportunity to drink something. And thank you for the hint. So where should I start again? Sorry. The interesting thing is, if you take a look how I initialize the extent, this gives me, like, the size of the image I want to allocate on the GPU. So in this case, I obviously have to start to cast it into an integer, because my image-wise was not defined as a unsigned integer. And in this case, I always have to use three dimensions. Like, I use the widths, the heights, and the depth. The other thing is, I have to also say, what is this memory going to be used, right? So is this going to be a sampler, which is essentially the way how a shader uses a texture? Or is this going to be used somewhere else? Like, is this going to be used by a compute shader or a geometry shader or something? Then I would need a different criteria here. Which for me, when I was reading through this one and trying to understand what's happening here, there's a Q index. So a Q is a thread inside the GPU which can execute things on the queue. Normally, as far as I understood, Android devices have two queues where I can execute graphic commands in parallel. And I'm just going to skip over the rest of the initialization parts of the image creation and go to the VK create image call. So there, I obviously have to take the Vulcan device, because I can have also a desktop device which has several Vulcan graphic cards, and have to tell him, okay, on which graphics card do I want to initialize this memory? So now I know that there is, like, I want to create an image somewhere, but it's not actually allocating space yet. So, like, there is no memory for it, it's just an opaque, description of what might come later on. So the thing is to find out what kind of memory I can create is I obviously ask the device first. I ask him, like, hey, okay, what do you have memory for this kind of image for me? And if you do, then I obviously say, okay, this will be this size. If you want to, if you want to create this memory for me, please, it should be this size and it should be this kind of style. The next step for me is like allocate memory type from properties. This method is intentionally left outside of this one because this is a library function you have to write yourself in order to find out if the type the graphic cards returns you is actually the type you want. So what it does, it loops bitwise over 32 bits and sees if like one of the return values has A, the right type, and B, the right size. If you found one, which I hope after this method you did, after this call to this method did, you can finally start allocating memory. This means like you reserve it, you found the right type, you found the right size. So please just allocate it into the text object memory. And then the final thing, which I find super interesting, is if you actually like, want to use it, you also not just only have to allocate the memory, but you also have to bind it. Yeah, similar but still different things are happening if you want to synchronize commands. So like in OpenGL, or if I go back to the original idea, the Ogillians can only talk in one direction, right? But the Vulkans have the ability to have like different threads. You can have fences. So like you say, I want to like compute something on the compute fragment or on the commute, compute command. And I can then also say, okay, this, I can have a stack of commands happening at the same time on the different queues, and I want both queues to wait till like a specific amount of commands are done. But the beautiful thing is like you design it. So like you take a look and what are your requirements for the graphics library, what for the object you want to render or the scene you want to do. And then you try to optimize it by hand by yourself. So you can obviously also fault harshly. So, and this is also part of the specification. If you are doing something, you have to be sure that you know what you're doing, because you can crash your Windows, you can crash your Android system, and then it reboots because you did something wrong with the memory. From a different kind of TV franchise, right? With great power comes great responsibility. So I don't have my Spider-Man costume on me, so I'm just gonna summarize what I tried to bring forward. So we have this OpenGL and we have Vulkan. Both are super nice graphics libraries and they are in broad use. Like on Android, you can use Vulkan for all the graphics you want, but you have to be sure that you're using the NDK because there are no Java bindings. Then again, for OpenGL, you have the Java bindings, and it takes a lot of away from you, right? Because you just say, okay, I want to create a texture, and this is the shader, compile it for me and put it into memory and just use it. In Vulkan, then again, you can be super fast. Like, if you take a look into, like, what is your memory consumption, what are the things you actually want to render? Do you want to have a full screen rendering? Then you do different things. You can design all the things, and you can specify all the things. The thing is, you have to. Right? So like there is so far no help. Like obviously there is help in case like you want to debug it somehow, you can reach out to communities, but ultimately you are responsible for it yourself. And I found it like super interesting to like have the power, right? I can fuck up the system and that's awesome, but I don't have to, right? Also, if you remember the slides I was showing before, the text is like it's super verbose and you have to know a lot of things. So just it can be super fun depending on what you're into. I have to finish my talk right now before she jumps at me. Just kidding. The graphics you were seeing here are obviously the LCAR system, right? It's the library computer archival and retrieval system. They're coming from LCAR 47, which I just recommend every tracker to take a look at. It's super nice. You can put it on your Raspberry Pi and have like a screen anywhere you want. Also, the beautiful called page lcars.com.net. Is like also helpful for those kind of things. The images for the planets, for instance, I didn't take with my own camera. They are coming from the NASA. The NASA had a Tumblr about like which planets we are coming from the Trek universe and how they actually look. So we saw Andoria and Vulcan. The sample codes are coming from the GitHub repositories from Google, and the slides can be found at bit.ly Vulcan. Vulkan BLN, I hope, yes. The last thing is, if you have questions for me, please shoot now. Also, if you want to have like one of those maybe not seeable beautiful stickers which are having the Vulkan salute, come to the GDG booth afterwards and do the Vulkan salute and you will get a sticker. Thank you.